from your program. Mr. Kernis did not stop with Colored Fields, but is continuing to compose. Just had a world premiere in Philadelphia for the opening of their new hall called Colored Wheel. He's now just about to begin work on Concerto for Toy Piano.
Thank you. This is an incredible thrill for me, I have to say. I'm just 42 years old, and to see that line of master composers out there on the wall, some of whom I've studied with, some of whom have been mentors, and others who I know simply by their incredible work, it's just truly a kind of dream that I should be and my work should be included with those in this line of wonderful composers. So I thank you so much. When I was a student, when this award just began, and it was first given to Witold Lutoslawski and to Harrison Birtwistle, and I just watched this in amazement and thought, oh, what a wonderful recognition, greater certainly gradually greater in recognition and in value than just about any other award around the world. It's just an amazing thing, and I can't believe I'm standing here with this quite formidable medal around my neck. So thank you very much. I'd like to, well, as Paul Brink said, the work of mine that has won this award is called Colored Field. And it's a work that is a rather central piece for me, and especially it's a central piece within a larger group of works that are I feel some of my best work, certainly some of my most serious work, that initially dates from between 1990 and 1995. Now, there are two versions of Colored Field. The one that won the award is a newer version that I made for cello and orchestra. I made that in 1999. But the original version of the piece comes from 1993 and was for English horn and orchestra. Between 1990 and 1995, I wrote a series of seven pieces, which now in hindsight I can call my war cycle or my war pieces. And I'm going to speak a little bit today about and sort of give you a bit of a sort of snapshot version of four of those pieces, take you a bit through them, give you a sense of the sound of those pieces, what went into them emotionally, what I was thinking during that period, and what started the process of making that series of works. Let me speak a little more loudly. So I've called this talk Music in the Time of War, not only, of course, because these pieces relate to war, but especially because we are living very much in a time of war. And I can already feel that within the arts, there's been a bit of a sea change because of September 11th. And its aftermath. For a long time, I actually think from, say, the late 40s until the mid-80s or so, the idea that music would reflect what was going on in the world, would reflect world events, even images from the world, was something that was frowned upon by many composers. There was a very strong influence in those years of, especially in those years, of abstraction and of a great deal of fascinating and terrific research that was going on musically, great expansion of musical techniques and ways of composing music, but there were other things that were lost during that period as well. There's a kind of focusing in a kind of exclusion of a lot of other work, and one of the things that went away for a while was the presence of music that was responding to the world. Now, that may have been a reaction somewhat to the Second World War, to music, to the arts that were going on in Soviet Russia, which were very populist, were very very much for the people, very sort of easy to understand in a lot of ways, very patriotic. And also it may have been a reaction to a general sense of nationalism that one found in music from early part of the 20th century up until wartime. That really happened in throughout the world, Scandinavia, America, composers, of course, like Sibelius, Copland, most well-known examples, Nielsen, Roy Harris, etc. But starting in the 50s, late 40s, in the aftermath of Anton Webern's death and the gradual building of new structures, of new ways coming out of, as I said, Webern and of Schoenberg, of 12-tone way of composing, as I said, the work became much more abstract for a long period of time. Only, I think, for many composers, once we got into the mid-80s, that began to relax. Once the more abstract kind of languages became one of many languages, and there became a great proliferation of many diverse languages, which have since the 80s become accepted within the musical universe as being quite varied and quite acceptable ways of musical expression. Of course, in the past, for centuries, composers and artists had responded directly to the world. From pre-Renaissance times, there was music created for the battlefield, to incite soldiers. A little later, in the late 1500s, early 1600s, there were keyboard composers that were in England and in France and Germany that were writing pieces called battle pieces, which were sorts of descriptions. Musical descriptions of battle and the various kinds of events. Some of the famous works that relate in some way or other to war would be the Haydn Mass in Time of War. And certainly there is some connection of the Eroica Symphony of Beethoven to Napoleon, which was originally dedicated the work to Napoleon, but when Napoleon turned out to not quite hold the values that Beethoven held dear, Beethoven got rid of that. Later in our time, in the 20th century, some of the best known works that come out of wartime are many of the symphonies of Dmitri Shostakovich, and of course the famous War Requiem of Benjamin Britten. And another kind of war, of course, a work that won the Grawemeyer a number of years ago, the First Symphony by John Pagliano, is a work that responds to AIDS and the deaths and suffering that disease has caused. So this is something that has been with us for many decades. There are also some very bad works among these, like the 1812 Overture, Wellington's Victories. Victory pieces that are not great music, but certainly have an incredibly patriotic and rousing feel to them. And it's certainly a tension when one writes works that may convey a national sentiment or pieces that have a potential to be more geared toward popular sentiment, that the works can, if one isn't careful, head over into a kind of jingoistic and but works that have a lot of bravura and fury but very little substance. And I hope that these works are going to be playing for you will not be in that group. As I said, now in hindsight, many years, 6, 7 years after the pieces were written, I can see these 7 works I'm going to speak to you about as a cycle. When I was writing them, I had no sense of that. I just was following my intuition, and I became more and more and more involved in reading about the wars that were going on at the time, in empathizing with situations around the globe. I started the first work, well, I'll tell you the names of these pieces. The first one was my Second Symphony, which I wrote in 1991. And that was really the piece that started this whole group of pieces. It came as a response to the Persian Gulf War. I was living up in Provincetown, Massachusetts at that time. Really up there, it's a sense of being cut off from the rest of the world. It's really, I think it's geographically the furthest, one of the furthest north places in the U.S. and very hard to get back to the mainland, especially in the winter. So I was watching a small black and white set as the Persian Gulf War unfolded. I felt very disassociated from it, being so distant, but it was utterly fascinating and utterly horrifying. Especially what was so fascinating to begin with was the media concentration on the war machinery and the fascinating new technology that had been developed. More commentators were spending time speaking about that the weapons and how cool they were than on what was actually taking place on the battlefield. We would see a lot of green tracer bombs, and a lot of reflected bombs, but really had very little sense of casualty, very little sense of what really was being won or lost in this war. So it felt really like a war at a great distance. And only later on, over the next few months, once the war was really going, I remember seeing, when I was back in Manhattan, in the New York Post, a cover, a front page, about a building in Iraq that had been accidentally bombed, thought to be a military installation, but just about a building that had 500 perfectly innocent civilians that had been flattened with all the inhabitants killed. There's been a way, and one certainly sees this in the conflict in Afghanistan right now, there's certainly been a way that's grown in the U.S. of minimizing the sense of what the casualties really are on the other side, either calling them, either not speaking about them, or not giving real numbers saying that they can't be verified, or of calling them collateral damage or some such term that will minimize in our minds the sense that actual real people, real civilians have been killed. So these were some things that incensed me and made me very intensely focused on this conflict. When the Gulf War started, I was about 30 years old, and I had been a bit too young to really have the Vietnam conflict make much of an impression on me, so this war was really the first I felt I was conscious of and really alerted to by the coverage. And this brought up this first piece, my Second Symphony. There are two essential elements in this piece. One is the idea of the human voice, and a symbol, the voice is a symbol of humanity. And throughout, since I'm speaking much more than I expected I would, we'll see if I can get to all of these pieces today, but one thing I think you'll hear fairly clearly in all the excerpts I'll play for you is the sense of a long line, a long melodic line. And melody is incredibly important to me. Melody for me is a, or it's not just melody, it's not something you may not recognize, it may just starting point A is to go on, you won't be able to hum it. You won't have a hook. But there is a line, and for me, there is a kind of melody. And in the Second Symphony especially, I place that melody against what I call the orchestral machine. And for me, that is the machinery, the machine of technology and the dehumanizing factors. And there's always a threat in this piece of one being overtaken by the other, of the human spirit being overwhelmed by the spirit of the idea of destruction and of brutality. The first movement will show very clearly this long line and a sense of great tumult and intensity. I'll begin by telling you a little bit about that. But this idea of voice and of line goes through my work. It's a very important aspect of my work in general. And you'll see it throughout these other excerpts. So this is a bit, two little excerpts of the first movement of the Second Symphony. And it comes, the movement that this comes from is called Alarm. Sense of growing threat and the possibility of annihilation. in this particular piece. In a way, this is probably, of all these works, the darkest one, the most sort of hair-raising in its way. The second movement is a great contrast to this by being more contemplative, presenting a very simple melodic line, which later on, as the movement goes on, begins being encroached upon by larger forces of the orchestra. I'll play a little bit of that for you as well. In the concert hall, it's been compressed and recording, but in the concert hall is probably one of the loudest things you'll ever hear, because, as I said, throughout, the percussion is always threatening to take over the line. At the end of the piece, they do. And the image of that building being flattened by an incorrectly dropped bomb was the impulse behind going all the way and really obliterating the entire orchestra at the end of the piece.
Thank you.
continued to be very drawn into what was going on in the world, and this has continued really ever since. Not long after this, really, the LA riots occurred, I think the following summer. And that was not long before the next election either, and I was asked to write a piece for the New York Philharmonic to look forward to the new, it was for the new tenure of their incoming music director, Kurt Mazur. And so I was thinking about that. I was thinking about the new millennium coming up in about under a decade. But as I was thinking about that, the LA riots occurred, and the neighborhood that I live in, Washington Heights, in Upper Manhattan, there was a sense that there was some violence that was going to break in that area as well. And I wound up using some of the influences of my neighborhood, which musical influences. There's a lot of Dominicans in my neighborhood, a lot of salsa being heard, a lot of rap, a lot of sense of urban, great urban activity. But yet this undercurrent at that time of potential violence and destruction within my neighborhood and within the United States. So I wrote a small piece called New Era Dance, which seems like it's very fun and very upbeat and full of the influence of jazz and salsa and Latin music, but actually has a very dark intention, a very dark side. And this piece, New Era Dance, is a short piece, about 7 minutes long. It's become one of my most played pieces. Partially, I think, because it seems so upbeat and fun, but it creates an incredible amount of energy and it's never going to spin, but actually has a very very dark concern about what the future actually holds. Following this work, it seemed at that time, as it does now, that there was just a succession of very frightening events in the world and conflicts that are bursting at the seams. And at that time I became, in 92, actually through that period, but I began to read more and more and become more aware of what was going on in Bosnia, the war in Bosnia. And it seemed that one work led to the next, one concern led to the next. And also in the late 80s, I had visited the concentration camps in Poland of Auschwitz and Birkenau and had retained a memory that I didn't quite know what to do with. It was a very numbing and very shaky, very uncomfortable experience that I'll speak about in a few minutes. But so all of these things were brimming under the surface, and I began to read a great deal about the conflict in Bosnia. And from that, and from the discovery that ethnic cleansing was going on in Bosnia, I began to make the obvious connection to the Holocaust. And being Jewish myself, I began to read a great deal about the Holocaust, about Judaism. I began to feel a greater connection to my heritage, the sense that if I had been, if I had been living in Germany during the Second World War, I would be dead as well. The sense of connection to my ancestors and my forefathers in a way, and so that developed a great deal of intensity that led into the work, of course. So what I really consider this war cycle really begins at this point with two. I consider these two pieces, the Second Symphony and the New Era Dance, to be preparatory works in a way, because I then wrote a solo violin piece called Aria Lament, in which elements of Judaic music, of music similar to what a cantor might sing, began to creep into the music. It was very sad music, very searching. And later on, five years later or so, I would then return to that music in another piece. Following that piece, I wrote a work called Hymn for solo accordion. And this solo accordion piece was the first that was clearly emotionally grounded in my responses to the war in Bosnia. And it feels, because I think the accordion is essentially a folk instrument, it brought out these influences for me. And it's both, it sounds almost like an organ, but with a kind of folk wheeziness and a quality that brought this mournful, yet organ-like, dirge-like quality. And I'm playing a little excerpt of that. Both of these pieces, the solo violin piece and the solo accordion piece, became very crucial, almost templates for what was about to follow. I worked out some ideas in these two solo pieces that I then developed in the next three pieces that are much larger works. So this is a little bit of the hymn for solo accordion.
Rivers of blood
suddenly nature dropped away, and I imagined, I just had this hallucination, in effect, which left me very, very shaken, and was left unprocessed for a while. So when this image came back to me when I was asked to write Colored Field, I was asked to write a concerto for English horn and orchestra, and this image of wind blowing the grass and blowing the trees at Birkenau came back to me. The sense that the wind was cleansing, that the wind was a symbol of time passing, and that through time passing, through the growth of, through the continuing beauty of nature, that on the surface, all of these horrors are covered over and could be forgotten. And this wind image came back to me, this sense of that something very horrifying is underneath the surface. It could be underneath the surface of wherever we're walking without our knowing it. And this became a very upsetting and kind of poignant in a way image that I used to help build Colored Field. In a way, the Second Symphony has this human voice against the machine, against the machine of technology and of weaponry in a way. Colored Field almost sort of puts that human voice within nature, within history, within something that seems calmer and more peaceful, but yet has this underlying, this unspeakable stuff underneath it. In being asked originally to write it as an English horn concerto, English horn is is an instrument very close in timbre to a kind of plaintive and sad human voice. And I again continued this idea of the human voice surrounded and buffeted by the orchestra and bi-orchestral sound. And Jewish Hebraic elements began to show up as well in this piece. Also a sense that this voice was sometime being covered over by many other elements and being covered, being annihilated a bit. So I'll play you a little bit of Colored Field. And later on in 1999, as I said, I made this version for cello. So this is a bit of the Grawemeyer Award-winning piece. I'll first play a little bit of the first movement.
Thank you.
long cello line, this long descending line, is varied quite a bit throughout the piece. As I said, always this threat that something's going to cover it over and eliminate it is present in the piece. Because time is short, I'm going to skip ahead a bit and just play you the very end of the piece. Now, unfortunately, in this lecture, I had to pretty much compress nearly two and a half hours of music into half an hour, so you're just getting the most cursory glance, series of snapshots of a few elements of the piece. But that's basically the first 2 minutes. I'll play you the last five. After 35 minutes has passed or so, the opening melody returns in a very purified form. The sense that after all the tension, all the textures, all the conflict that has occurred in this piece, that there's a moment of rest, a moment of a sense that there could be almost a sense of apprehending paradise for a moment and the possibility of peace. And that gradually is covered over in layers and layers and layers of these wind chords from the beginning, but very dark and clotted and dissonant, and they just take over completely the lines that you first heard. This begins a little bit of the, I'm going to move ahead. Okay, sorry. Following completing this work, I launched immediately to a chamber work called Still Movement with Him, which is very much in the same kind of expressive realm of this piece, but very much using sounds of church bells. It's for piano, violin, viola, and cello. There's also a version of clarinet. Using funereal bells, very long lines and strings, very new brand and influence, and also dedicated in memory of my friend Stephen Albert, who died tragically while the piece was being written. Following that piece, I took, it was 1995, actually I think 1994, and I took the opportunity to write a piece, to finish this group of pieces off with a piece dedicated in, to honor the 50th anniversary of the end of the Holocaust. This provided for me a sense of ending, a sense of resolution, in part, as much as one can have resolution, a sense of having to complete the cycle of pieces, of wanting to go on, of wanting to look at other things in my music, of look more toward, actually at that time, looking toward the new millennium as a source of hope. I just was married around that time and wanted to break the cycle of, break this war cycle of my life in a way. And so what I did in this work is I went back to the solo violin piece that I wrote called Our Lament, and use that as the basis for this piece. It's a piece for string, for violin solo and strings. And as I said, with Colored Field, you could see that as a voice within nature, within history, being covered by nature, covered by history. This piece is in a more spiritual realm. It takes its image, the idea of a cantor, which is the violinist, and a congregation, a synagogue, the string orchestra. And there are two sections. One is more lament-like and the other is more consoling. And at the very end of the piece, actually throughout the piece, I quote some of the previous four pieces. But the very, very end, and I'll play this, I'll play the little bit of the opening and the end, I bring this primary melody of Colored Field back. It's a similar moment, a sense of finding possible peace, and instead of dissolving as darkly as it does in Colored Field, it finds an uneasy kind of easy resolution, which gives us, gives me at least, the idea of being able to go on, being able to continue. So I'll play a few little excerpts of this.
Thank you.
in an oboe solo that has never appeared anywhere else in the piece, and it's a percussion in the background. It's a very, after hearing only strings and violin for 20 some odd minutes, it's a very striking ending. As I close, I'd just like to mention something that was very important in the creation of these pieces, and I think is very an aspect I consider to be very important in composing in general. And that's the course of a 5-year period of writing these works. And also this very, this use of metaphor that I've spoken about, the human voice, the various placing the idea of voice within these different contexts, enabled me to create a certain distance between myself, my emotions, and these very large structures that I was setting out to create. There wasn't so much, I never had a sense really that I was reacting, that I was in such a white heat that I was setting down on the page what I felt at any given moment. I had many months, and some cases nearly a year, in which a piece would take for fruition. So I had to be able to sustain feelings for a long time through structure and through metaphor. And through very careful working with the material. And this enabled me, I think, to build, I hope, more into the music than just, as I said, immediate reaction, but to find something that I hope is larger and more universal and more not just of our time, but that refers to suffering, loss, and grief at any time. And for any people, I hope. I mean, that's a large thing to hope that one's work relates to. But I do hope that. I think in the next number of years, we're going to be seeing a lot of response to what happened on September 11th. Already, I spoke to some composers who, within 1 week of that situation, created entire symphonies or entire string quartets. And I think that it would take not much longer than 1 week to process what has happened here. For composers who were set on responding to that, I would urge some caution, some careful thinking, reflection over time. I thank you very much for being a great audience. I'd like to ask if you have any questions for me. I think I can take a few more minutes and answer a question or two if you'd like. I probably can't even see any hands from here, but still I'll ask. Yes?
In the cello piece, heard part of the Reschke Third Symphony and felt that there were a lot of similarities, the voice versus the, or in lieu of the cello, and some of those wonderful modulations. Did that have any influence on you?
I don't think that piece specifically had an influence on me, but the music of certainly the Polish school, more actually Penderecki's and Nowakowski has had an influence on me, but yet as you take some of those textures and begin to apply consonant harmonies, I can see why you might think that, and I definitely feel a debt to those composers of the kind of sound world that they make by piling chord upon chord upon chord. Can't see anyone.